All right. Starting to regret having started this video. Here we go.
Nobody should be following this video. Nobody. Use the manual.
It is time to change those valves. We have our kit. A couple of nice new Kibblewhite Black Diamond valves. We're gonna need our gaskets and our stem seals. Okay, we need to remove the radiators and we need to drain the coolant. That is the first step of this procedure. We're gonna loosen this bolt here and open the rad cap and let the fluid flow. And it's flowing. And as predicted, it's making a giant bloody mess. I hate coolant. Let's see if that'll take care of this puddle issue we've got going. Take two. Oh, yeah. There we go. That's the old stuff. While this drains, we're gonna remove the exhaust pipe. Ooh, T4, big reverse megaphone. Oh, yeah. Time to remove radiators. One bolt there, one bolt there. Remove this plasticky thing. We're gonna disconnect the hoses on both sides and get them out of the way. Okay, I've removed this radiator. Ah, there we go. Okay, with the left side radiator out, this has lots of play, so I should be able to get in there and remove this header and the other header. Rads, this side I'm just leaving sort of in place so I don't have to, you know, mess with all of the pipes and whatever. So headers are out, and now we're gonna remove this bit. We're going to have to remove the carb. No, oh, excuse my buddy. We're gonna remove these bits, deco lever, and get ready what we're doing. What are you doing over there? Notice another pig on the workshop. Yes. It has a seized swing arm. Is anyone shocked by that? See our other video up here, or whatever they do. Up here, or is it here? I don't know. See this video.
Smash the bell icon.
Like and subscribe, man. This puppy came out. That was easy. Now we're going over to the other side to remove the bracket. Yes. A little bit of corrosion and oxidation on one of the bolts that came out of the frame bracket, but we're not going to grease it when we put it back in because it helps make the earth happen. So we're just going to get off the oxidation with a wire brush and put it back in. Next step, remove the carb. Each carb is different. Have fun battling it yourself. That's your problem. I don't usually pull the swing arm or the subframe up, but I think others do. I'm just gonna manhandle this puppy. Remember, boys and girls, you need to keep it at top dead center when you're doing engine work. Why? To relax the cam and the tension on the head, because if you don't, those cams are pushing up, and as you start to remove it, it can go and cause problems. It can go, you see. You don't want that. Finding top dead center, the correct way to do it is to open this sight and make sure that the groove is lined up with the T. I don't usually do that. I put it in fifth gear, and I start rotating the rear wheel, and I keep a screwdriver in there waiting for it carefully to come to the top. If it touches, it starts coming up, you start to feeling it touching the screwdriver, slow down a bit. As soon as you can feel movement in all of the valves, then you've reached top dead center. Unless, of course, your valves are so tight, they're not giving you any feel. Okay, lots and lots of loose bolts ready for this thing to come out. Have I missed any? Can anyone see that I've missed any? I bloody well missed some. Don't forget the ones that are inside the valve cover. And there's another one that might hide. The deco perch is also a structural bolt. It's not just there to look pretty. 14 bolts have come out of that puppy. The big ones go in the big holes, the little ones go in the little holes, the long ones go in the long holes, the short ones go in the short holes. I'm gonna try to take this off by pulling up on the deco lever. Yeah, there it goes, see, pop up. There we go. A couple of taps with the rubber mallet on this side, and she's loosey-loosey. Come right off. This is the special tool for trying to beat the shizzle out of the swing arm axle. But as we know, it ain't happening in one or two hits. So hit the, look at this one, this video here or there, I can't remember which, and smash that like and subscribe button. Excellent. Despite this being 8 years with me, and I'm the fourth owner, rockers look excellent. I have no idea if somebody else has done them, but I haven't. I did put in the stage one cam, and she's sitting right there, also looking good as new. Next job, remove the cam chain tensioner, these two bolts, the top and bottom bolts. Top and bottom bolts, right?
Loosen, just loosen them. These two also.
Okay.
And then you remove the center one.
Okay, done. Now what? Okay, so what? You've slotted a small screwdriver into a flathead that's hiding inside.
Yeah, which holds the spring.
Okay.
The cam chain tensioner.
So you can't let it twist.
I can't let it run. The moment I unscrew it,
yeah,
it'll rush forward because it's trying to tension the cam because I'm unscrewing it.
Uh-huh.
But then you can't read
how far your
chain tensioner has been used. So because with that you can determine the wear of the cam chain.
Right, whether we need to replace the cam chain or not.
Yeah, or just have a look. It's just information, yeah?
Okay, so you held it with the screwdriver so it didn't twist. Uh-huh. And it's showing?
It's this far. Yeah? In. So if I let go, you'll see how much is left.
Not a hell of a lot.
Not a hell of a lot.
So maybe it's time
but
for cam chain
too? You see,
too?
It was here.
Yeah, about. Yeah.
So there's still, I would say 20,000 kilometers or 10 or 15 left. But you see this?
Yeah.
So normally you can extract this all the way. I don't know how far it sits when it's new. You see how far it goes in all the way.
So we're about halfway, it looks like, I would have said.
A bit more.
A little more than halfway. We're going to remove this Allen bolt and the one that's on the other side. So I'll loosen this one. I'll rotate the wheel and the bikes in gear so it'll turn this around until I get the other one. Take them both out, and then we'll remove the sprocket, the cam, and the bearings. To hold this in place while I loosen these Allens, I've slid something in here. Just be careful you don't deform or scratch or mash this area, this surface. I've already cracked it loose. They're not very tight because they're not doing a whole lot of hard work, so they're loose and ready to be pulled out. Okay, tie a wire on so that you don't lose the whole 9 yards. And then we can remove the cam and the bearings.
La la la. Imagine how many kilometers, and there's not so much as a scratch. Ooh.
So now I've got the cam sprocket out, and I've got the chain dangling at the end of my wire. Having mopped up the big puddles of oil, I am now going to remove the bolts. Having a gander at my valves here, I'm not sure if we can see it. Yeah, you can actually see, you can just make out that at the top of this, the top of the valve is actually starting to be indented. There, that you can see very clearly. Same with this one. So those guys are kaput in more ways than one. Tell me what that is.
It's a plunger.
A plunger, not a plunger.
Yeah, so it pumps.
And it pumps oil. I saw it squirt oil when you just did that. So it's that stays in place though, yeah?
Yeah, with the spring, so don't pull it out.
Okay. And also, this is loose, so if you've got your magnet, it'll come out. Careful. And it's missing its O-ring because, thankfully, it's over in the valve cover, so we're okay. But bear in mind, there needs to be an O-ring there. This is loose, and it will come out if you muck around. And there are washers here. And you don't want to drop them down in the rest of the engine because that makes the project a bit more complicated. As with the valve cover, I'm now going to gently start tapping around carefully on the head to try to loosen it up from the gasket that's been sealing it for ages and ages. And it should come straight up. And thank you, and we love you, Mr. Honda, for allowing us to do all of this without removing the engine out of the bike.
Wow.
And the head is off. Having a gander inside.
Look, you can still see the hone marks.
You can still see the honing on the cylinder walls.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I can see it from here. It won't show up in the camera for sure.
No.
And tell me about the coloration, the What do you
it's
see?
Okay, it looks okay. It's not like beautiful brown, but there's no big carbon buildup.
True, and it wasn't long ago.
And it's not clean. If it's clean, you would be burning oil. Sometimes the piston gets clean because there's so much oil coming in. Ah. But since you don't use oil, you don't have that problem.
Right, bikes never used oil. And it wasn't long ago I was running too rich. Does that possibly influence?
Yes.
Potentially?
A bit. No, it looks okay.
Excellent. All right, we're doing the illegal move.
Are you done?
We are just going to show me what you're using. It's basically a spark plug remover. We have to smack it. And Bob's your uncle. These two little pieces are already split in half, the collet. And they create a cone together when they're in. And to get them out, it's as easy as that. I don't know why anyone would complain about that. Someone can tell me.
Note the direction how the springs are built in.
Springs are built in and... Oh, they've got the tighter coil at the bottom. Okay, good to notice. And yeah, we are looking at the springs, the valve, and the valve
stem seals,
which we're going to also replace during this whole procedure. Okay, what's next? The other one.
Bah. This one didn't work properly.
Okay, that one got in a little wonky, but it came out in the second hit. And then we'll need to find all those pieces.
There, we have them.
Cool. Apparently this is not recommended.
Well, it just looks stupid. It's fine. They're destroyed anyway. You can't.
Yeah, we weren't going to use them again anyway, so what's the matter if it... Okay, so let's see those valves.
So now we have the bottom pieces.
Uh-huh. Those are...
These are washers, more or less, so the springs... don't run in the aluminium, they are steel, these things.
Uh-huh, okay.
You see?
Yeah.
Because this is soft.
Because the rest of it is aluminium.
So the spring, you see, it's like a guide which holds the spring.
Yep.
So let's see what we're getting.
We're going to push that out and see if we have a pizza cutter.
Oh, yeah. This is the mother of all pizza cutters.
Oh, Lord have mercy. Let's see if we can see it.
See the edge?
Yes. Oh, shit. We'll compare it with the new one. Right, so a few things to think about here.
If the stem seal starts leaking...
Yes.
The oil flows down the valve shaft.
And if it did, it would look wet.
It was wet. Look at this one.
Yeah.
You see that it's a bit... Okay, of course, there's fuel going into this side. But
yeah. But this one's not like that. So this one's getting...
This one is even carbon there, so it's kind of like it burnt oil as well.
Okay. Well, look in that hole.
Same, that's fine.
Yeah, same. They're both dry. Oops, they're both dry, but yeah. It's well overdue.
No, the worst is this guy. This is just crazy.
Oh, that's like just got a lip on it left.
Yeah, that's it.
That's not metal. This is a hair. But holy crap.
Yeah.
Well, it was time.
You see that?
What am I looking at? I'm looking at...
You see that stream?
This line.
And puddling.
Yeah.
Puddling there. You can see
it. So there was oil going in there.
You can see it was... You see this?
Yep.
Coming down and then it was sitting here puddling. Because you're on the side stand, so the oil goes to the left.
Uh-huh.
You see?
Yep.
So, yeah. You see that?
Yeah.
Yeah. So something was coming out of there and then going...
So it was leaking ever so slightly. Well, I said that was a hair. It's not. That's a small, small sliver of valve. Hey, we were overdue. This is the new kibble white we're going to put in. See the meat? It's hard to see, but boy, what your finger tells you. That could cut you. That you can cut your finger on. And this one here... is nice. Lots of meat left. New day, new game. We are going to start grinding in the valves with grinding paste. We got a brand new valve. We've marked it so that we know which side is which. We got the grinding paste. We're going to put a little grinding paste around the rim of the valve. And then we're going to go wagga 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 in there with these suction cup doohickeys. And I'll try to get a bit of video of that in just a mo. Oh, there's some new learning. We've put a little bit of engine in oil in there to lubricate it, Kidogo. Making it a nice paste.
You're not allowed to get paste onto the shaft.
Not allowed to get paste onto the shaft.
Because then you'll...
Oh, because it will be abrasive and it will scratch up the... valve seals. The valve... what you call it? shafts. So the purpose of this procedure, of course, is to try to mate the surface of the new valve with the fairly abused seat.
We should actually clean that later, actually.
There. Nice. All right. This primitive tool is the best plan.
Yeah, if it works.
It's so annoying. When it's working, it's like it's looking like this. So I'm happy with this one. It's very difficult to see with a cell phone, but it's got a more dull finish on the mating surface and a few very thin sort of lines compared to the fresh valve, which is just polished from the factory. Idea should be that these two surfaces have now bedded in and mated. They are a nice tight fit. A little brake cleaner on both the suction cup and the top of the valve helped get them to stick, and now they hold. So we do this like three times until it really starts to sound smooth, and then you get a little more paste on it, start again, get a little more paste on it, start again. Not hard.
All right. You got your grid on there, and you're just making fire, oh, like our ancestors. Oh. And it'll do that every 5 seconds, unless you figure out a better way to get it to grip than me. But you lift it up a bit, put it back down. Lift it up, put it back down. Lift it up, put it back down. Lift it up, put it back down. Lift it what? Put it where? That's right.
More fun, ladies and gentlemen. My exhaust valves are also crap, so we're gonna do those. However, we don't have new ones, we're going to use some pretty good used ones. And of course, then if it's got a used surface, the suction cup method won't work. And so, we're going to make a plan with a drill, a piece of heavy-duty hose pipe, and pulling from the other side. Okay, so we have the valve in. We've got a piece of hose pipe over there stuck over the top of the valve and onto a drill that fits in there nicely, a drill bit. We'll put our paste in carefully from this side. Now, very clever. Okay, yeah, it's that's the before, and that's the after. So yeah, maybe, you know, probably it was overdue a little. Okay, we are putting on the stem guides, seals, stem seals. They've got a little spring on them, you put a little bit of oil, and you just press them on real careful, and they slip right on, which is great. Don't do the last one, that's for me.
Okay.
Yeah. They come in the Athena gasket pack, and there's the number if you want it. The next bit involves special tools. We've got a spring compressor, because obviously, now we need to get these valves back up in here, and surround them with these really tight springs and get all these little collars and collets back in place. And you're not gonna do it with your thumbs. Give me that.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So it needs to sit like that. And then it mounts in there and you squeeze them both together. That makes
sense. Yeah, and then you adjust
and it gives you space to put the collets
like
in. Yeah. A little bit of oil in there.
Right.
Right. Coming around the side. Right, we've got all our bits and bobs. The collets, the whole purpose is so you can get the collets in. All right, so you get the idea. We're compressing the spring from both sides by holding onto the top of the valve. And that's, should that be the side that squeezes or this side?
It doesn't matter. You have to get to a certain distance.
And then you can fit the collets in.
Yeah.
So the valve is poking out. Now we probably ought to be able to get those little collets in there. Remember, these two are like two half cones.
Yeah.
So this is a job for a blob of grease and a small screwdriver, huh?
Adhesion. Is that the right word in English?
Sticky. Don't get too complicated. You can do it. Put your glasses on your face. There! Oh, the wise old mechanic. I don't know if it needs to be said, but these cones are like narrow or tapered bit down. I'm enjoying watching this bit. This is fun. Fiddle. Also, it's impressive that we're keeping this family friendly. I haven't heard a single f*** from my panic mechanic. Whee! It's in! So now, if he slowly releases the pressure from the other side, see, he's loosening. We ought to set that, the spring should create tension. And squeeze that valve in place, and voila!
Just hold the head.
Just like fresh from the factory.
To set the collets, to make sure they're set, just to set them.
Just a tap again, we've got that same thing.
That's it.
So you're sure? That's just a way of...
You can see how they're sitting.
Yeah,
they're just nice. A way to set them properly.
You can tell, I mean, they're flush with the top, basically.
Yeah.
Nice. Need a tripod if I'm gonna do this shit. Or just not do this shit. It's also an option. There we go. Yes. No, don't fall over. Yeah.
Oh, you bastard. You bastard.
I think in general I need to go in deeper than I have been. That's what she said. This is seriously fun. It's refusing, as they say. It is refusing. Oh, that is such a good tool. Fuck, stupid thing falls out. I bet when Alan Milyard does this, it takes him 30 seconds. So I got out my screwdriver, and I put the collets in about 15 seconds. I was quite chuffed with that. Yeah, and it turned out perfect. It was the sixth collet that I'd handmade with a pair of pliers and a toothpick and 17,000 different files.
And a hacksaw.
And I'd reassembled this engine, which had 8 cylinders. It originally had 2. And I was quite chuffed with that. And look, Tracy's brought me a cup of tea. And the hedgehogs are back at it again. I got there in the end, as they say. Oh my God, painful. Well, I spent a little bit of time and got the valves and the springs back in, and the collets all fit in nicely. So I'm gonna go and see if anything's going on in the kitchen. I come into the kitchen and I find that Pete is making tea. That's fantastic. Pete, is there any cake or cookies? We're gonna clean this thing up. I am gonna use a wire brush inside here, but not on the flat surfaces. For the flat surfaces, I'm gonna use acetone and a flat blade to try to get off some of these old bits of gasket rubber and whatnot, and at the end, a flat oil stone, and just carefully sort of make the whole surface as flat as I can get it. And that's the plan. All right, that's been cleaned up well enough. It's mostly to get this surface that mates flat with the gasket to be clean. And no unevenness, no goop left over from the previous gasket. That discoloration doesn't matter. On to the top of the cylinder. We're going to use acetone again to kind of let it help get rid of some of the gunk. And then we're just going to carefully polish around the flat surfaces that mate with the gasket and along this side. We're going to maybe stuff a rag down in there so that we don't drop a bunch of foreign material
or contaminant
in there. Don't forget to tidy up the top surfaces of the top of the head. Time to reinstall the cylinder head. So for that job, you need the cylinder head gasket. Any grease, anything?
No grease.
Nothing at all.
Hell no. Nothing.
Just straight on.
Yeah.
All right. Putting on the head, but there's only one way this puppy goes. There's more holes on this side than on this. And you can see this little cutout sits where the fixed chain slider goes.
So why are there more holes in the front?
Why is there more on the exhaust side? Because it's hotter, is hotter there.
Yes.
And more coolant goes through there.
Yeah.
There are more holes here. Coolant is coming up through the body of the cylinder. And the coolant is coming up. And it's hot as shizzle over here. So it needs more than on this side. So I have one pin here and one pin there. Whether that complicates things or not. Must bear in mind.
Put it on without scratching the chamber.
Yeah. Okay.
No.
So for all the kids at home, we're putting the valves at the bottom. Just gotta get that one pin past the gasket. Before I begin tapping, I'm gonna make sure things are lined up. Tight little fit. That's seating. Okay, so I still have my cam chain available. Didn't squish anything between the gasket and the head, so that's installed. Now we need to put the nuts and thick washers back on. These fellas. And they have a torque spec, which I will tell you in a moment. These guys, these four at the top, are 67 Newton meters. You are supposed to put oil on the bolts and then tighten this up to its 67 Newton meters in two steps. So we're going to go to 30 something, get those tight, and we're going to go in an X pattern. And start here, go there, over there, and back here. I need to hold the bike. That's 35. So that's 60.
Yeah.
And that is 65. 67. Going back to the one I started with. Right?
Mm-hmm.
This feels horrible.
It does.
Just so you know, this feels awful. It's a horrible feeling. It's scary. And it's okay. You can do it! Oh God. This one does worry me. Oh, thank you! I believe in Honda. Ah, thank you. Come on, 20-year-old bolts. And that is 4 clicks. Okay, now that the head is back on, the job is to find top dead center, doing it the correct way. So we got to go in here. We're looking for the correct mark at top dead center, which is the past the T, about a millimeter or two. All right, look, this has got to be seen. So that we can spin it, we've got this dowel in there that Uncle Pete has that you're not going to have, but figure something out, yeah? So that when I turn everything, it doesn't fall in. and it doesn't get snagged on anything. You can no longer use your wire.
Screwdriver trick then. Are you in fifth gear?
Yep.
Yeah, go, now. I need to have a squat somewhere.
Oh, okay. We're okay?
You just do your thing, I'm holding this.
Okay. Okay, it's coming up. Here we go. Now.
I need my glasses!
Okay. Now I see my F, and here comes the T. There, I'm lying. You wanted to crawl back. There we go.
Is there no mark behind the T? Just let me have a look.
There may be. So there's F to the left and T. We're sat on T right now. Old and older.
It's fine.
Just leave cool. It. Cool. Alright. Alright, what now?
So now you got the cam chain sprocket.
Cam chain sprocket, good.
And then you have to try to pima it with your eyes. The mark is there.
Yeah.
It should be straight with this.
So you gotta bend down and look straight across the top.
I'm a tooth out, probably.
Okay. Yeah.
So what you do, you just lift it one tooth and you just go like this.
Yeah.
You see now, there we are.
Nice. And so if you come down totally horizontal, look, that's perfect.
Yeah, so now normally how you check that when the cam is in, you press at the cam chain tensioner because it changes a bit, but
okay. So now we can get the cam. Right. We've carefully put in the cam. You can put the lobes sort of down so that they're each at an angle down because they're not touching anything because it's a top dead center. And that lines up the screw hole as well. So it's kind of obvious how to do that. So the screw hole is lined up and now I'll put in the screws and tighten them down. The seal needs to be on the outside here and open on this side so you can see the bearings on this side. When we lined it up, it was perfectly set up so that you can see the line. See, it's perfectly aligned.
Yeah.
Straight across there. You can see that EX. That dot needs to line up right with the very top of the head. Now,
if you put pressure on it, it'll go back.
It pops back up a little bit, but it's still visible. That's the key or what?
Yes.
Okay.
Because if it's too far, you can see it. If it's a tooth out, you can see it.
Okay. So we're trying to make sure the timing is right. Right. I've got this finger tight and I'm going to just make sure it's snug enough. It's close enough. Then I'll rotate it around and get to the other side. There we go. Just till it kisses. Now we rotate it around by moving the wheel. Okay. Now we got the next one. We'll put a little bit of blue Loctite on that and we'll tighten that one up finger tight. We're going to hold it with a round pin. It shouldn't damage anything. 25 newton meters on that, Allen. We have removed the center bolt from the tensioner. And now we're putting in the outside bolts. There's a new gasket in there that comes with the Athena kit. Nipping them down. So you slide a little screwdriver in there, find the notch.
There's actually a screw.
There. And then twist it?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, and it comes loose.
Yeah.
And it just spins free. Zoop.
And that's it, and now it's tensioned.
Perfect.
And then you check here.
Uh-huh.
You see the EX mark.
And we're still at the EX mark. Brilliant. Oh yeah, look at that. Bam. Doesn't get better. New day, time to reassemble. And you need to put, what is this? I don't know. Gasket maker, yes. Gasket maker over the outside of the... Stop it! Gasket maker over the surface. You don't need to put a heap of it on there. Just enough. Tap it on with your finger. And that's plenty. Like a so, yeah? Cover it, but don't blob it on. So I cleaned the surfaces with acetone, both on the lid and on the head. And then have dabbed on that gasket maker. I put a little, mostly on the head, and then a little tiny bit on some of the hard to reach areas within here. Now we're gonna stick it back on. There are no O-rings on this part of the assembly, but there are two pins, one here and one here. We're back on. I've replaced all of the bolts, all 14 of them. It was very easy to figure out where they go. I don't think there was any art to figuring that out. 8mm bolts are 23 newton meters, and the little ones are 12 newton meters. It's tightened down. The next job is to check the valves. I know there are videos out there showing how to check the valves. I'm not going to show you. Adjustment made. 15 and 20. Double check that in the manual. So we'll just finish up this little video with a view of world's most beautiful motor. I don't mean the XR650R. I mean my XR650R, the most beautiful motorcycle in the world. Big motorcycle, red motorcycle. Can beat anybody else's motorcycle. There's no chance in hell anyone's gonna beat my motorcycle because it's the XR650. It lives in Africa. Kenya, Africa, Africa, and Kenya. It's East Africa. It's where people live in the east of Africa. It's a very, very interesting place, East Africa. It's got the best riding in the world if you have an XR650R. Good luck to all the rest of you bozos out there who do not live in East Africa, who will not be riding in January, because I will be riding in January because it's hot in January. See, it's sunny outside. And you guys are in the cold and the rain, crying about how everything's shit and your economy's going to hell. Well, let me tell you about the Kenyan economy. It's absolutely in the toilet. But that doesn't affect me because I have an XR650R. World's best motorcycle, ladies and gentlemen. World's best motorcycle. And that's enough for me. Goodbye.